Welcome to today's members webinar, guys. I'm Tim from RaceCraft, and today we're going to get stuck into looking at some math channels in the context of data analysis. Before we get started with the actual lesson today, I just want to go through a little bit of a pre-show, give you guys a little bit of an update about what's been happening around the place for us. So in the last webinar, I talked through that we were going to be installing MoTeC's V2 camera system into our RaceCraft GT86 shop car. So I got that installed during last week, and we managed to get it out on track and do a little bit of a run. And I just wanted to give you guys, show you guys on my laptop screen what that data looks like now that we've got the video system set up to be synchronized with the data. So if you just head across to my laptop screen for a second here, I've actually got a video tab set up. So what we've got here in the top right is just some generic log data that we gathered on Friday. This is just some really basic stuff: engine speed, vehicle speed, throttle and brake, and gear position here. But the new addition for this particular car was to add in the MoTeC camera system. So there's lots of different camera systems you can use. A lot of people, particularly at maybe the more budget-friendly end of the spectrum, you can use things like GoPros and stuff, and you can do manual synchronization between your data and your video. There's really great either free or cheap tools that can help you do that for you as well, help you synchronize your data and your video. The beauty of buying maybe something slightly more higher end, like something like MoTeC Make or PI from Cosworth, is that all of that synchronization is done for you. There's no post-processing work involved with synchronizing it. And the really nice thing about that is it's one less step to have to complete during a race weekend, and it just really speeds up your analysis process. It means you can load the data and go straight into getting into analysis without having to mess around with the data before you sit down with your driver and go through the data. So I just want to show you an example of what's going on here. So as I move the cursor through the lap, you can see that the video is automatically updating through the lap, which is really nice. If I just scan through, it shows is exactly where we are on track in the video in the top left, and I can really easily correlate that with the log data. Now, one of the times that becomes really important or really helpful is when you're comparing two different drivers, particularly from the perspective of driving lines. So driving lines is something you can look at in the log data. Sometimes you can make use of GPS data, although that can be a little bit flaky sometimes. Other times you can use cornering radiuses and a few lateral G calculations to understand how the car is being driven differently in the corner. But when it comes to video, there's absolutely no arguing or question about where you are on track. If you've got the in-car video, you can see exactly where the car was at every point on track, so it can be really useful. So in the same way that if I just come over to my data on the side here, in the same way I can select a lap to overlay, and it'll give me an overlay on the log data. It also gives me the exact same overlay in the video as well, and both of these are purely perfectly synchronized together. So the beauty of this being synchronized together, obviously it's being synchronized over distance. So the position I click on the data means you're going to be locking onto the exact same position on track with the camera. So if you had a specific disparity or an area on track you wanted to look at the difference in, you can come along to the video and see really quickly if the car was positioned. Maybe one driver has turned in early, or one driver is taking a lot more curb than the other. It can just be a really nice reference. So if I just get rid of that overlay for a second, you can see on the top left, one of the nice features, and a lot of the camera manufacturers will do this for you, whether it's a camera manufacturer that comes from the same supplier that's selling you your data system, or whether it's something completely different, something like a GoPro. There's always the ability to be able to overlay some sort of heads-up display, which is what we've got shown in the top left here. So in this case, we've got the gear, we've got a GG plot. It's probably a little bit small for you guys to see there, but when you're looking at this in full screen, it's a bit easier. In fact, I can do that right there. And then the lap number, then we've got some lap times here, the current speed, and the throttle and brake as well, which is just a really nice reference. If you're just watching the video by itself, there's quite a lot of information there if you're already doing a comparison by yourself. The beauty of this system as well, which is the same as many systems, you don't actually need to have the data analysis package open to view it. It's also available as an individual video file. So you can just give it to a driver or someone that doesn't know how to use the data analysis package, and they can, because of that nested data in the top left there, they can just use any computer to view that video, and they can already start to do a little bit of their own basic analysis straight away. So I think that's a nice addition to the Racecraft car. In addition to that, we've also got the VBOX system, which is a similar system, maybe a little more low end, a little more entry level, but we've got the VBOX system fit in there. The beauty of the VBOX system, not only does it log data as well, it actually has two video inputs. So actually looking at the MoTeC screen here on my laptop again, we've actually got one of the VBOX cameras actually in shot. So there's one of them that's got a forward looking view, and we've got this one here that I've highlighted, which is actually rearward looking back at the driver, which again is just to give a little bit more context about what was going on with the driver. It can be helpful, particularly in like a video coaching situation. In addition to that, the third logging system, so we've got the MoTeC, we've got the VBOX, we've got a third logging system, which is an AIM, which is a little bit more of a portable solution, which is something that sort of bolts to the dash. That does have an option to have a camera with it, but that's not something we're using at the moment. So certainly that car is getting relatively heavily instrumented now, and that's really all just to support, help us generate material for our data logging courses, particularly some worked examples with lots of different systems for you guys. One of the other things that's been going on around the shop, it's the same car with the Racecraft GD86. We've been installing a surge tank in it. So we have had a fuel surge tank, I should say. We have had a few problems lately with the car surging when the tank hasn't got enough fuel in it. So this is something that's getting worse and worse with this car as we end up increasing the performance, and particularly lately, now that we've started running Michelin slicks on it, which are a bit of a step up from the semi-slick that was being run on in the past, this fuel surge issue is getting even worse. So we've been getting the guys in the workshop to fit a fuel surge tank to the back of the car. It already had some upgrades in the tank to help with the fuel surge, but now this is just a bit more of a serious solution with an external surge tank, which will allow us to run the tank much lower. And I've actually got a picture up here on my laptop screen that I took yesterday when I was walking through the workshop. So this is this black tank here it's actually sitting upside down on the bench. The guys are halfway through installing it at the moment, but essentially this is a completely separate tank from the main fuel tank. The idea is that out of the main fuel tank, rather than the original pumping to the fuel rail at front, we reroute that into the surge tank. So the first thing that gets filled out of the main tank is the surge tank. Then the surge tank, it's got its own separate high flow pump, which is what you see here, which is attached to the surge tank. That then runs to the fuel rail, and then with the fuel rail, rather than being returned to the main tank, instead it actually returns to the surge tank. So the idea here is that we're trying to keep the surge tank as full as possible all of the time. And you can see with this, obviously this thing's sitting upside down, but you've got this sort of whole body of the tank here, but this sort of section down the back here is obviously the lowest part, and that is the part that is going to be feeding that new pump that's going in the back. So that's been a little bit of a challenge for the guys to package that. Inevitably in these road cars where there's already a lot of equipment in them, and it's usually quite a challenge to fit something into the car itself, fit something new. There's always something in the way. It's always a massive compromise. This was no exception to that. So the guys have been making a bracket and getting that fitted into the car, and that'll be getting plumbed hopefully tomorrow, so we can get it back out on track, and hopefully we've improved that fuel surging issue. The one of the other projects that's been going on in the workshop is our other GD86, which is our SR20 VET powered, what we're calling our SR86, which is the cooling project has been continuing. So I think in the last webinar, I talked a little bit about the ducting. If we just switch over to the overhead cam here, I'll show you guys the ducting updates we've been doing. So I think I had this in the last webinar. What's happening here is this is that where the oil cooler for the main oil cooler for the engine is sitting here, and that is obviously a pretty square profile. So we've already got a duct that's coming off the back of that oil cooler, which is running into this profile here. So the idea here is that this face here will face the oil cooler, and this is going to have a foam tape around it, and it's just going to seal against the oil cooler. And then this face here is at the outlet of the bumper. So the way this is actually positioned in the car is this is the front wheel. So this is the front of the car in this direction. This is the front of the front left tire in this case. So that kind of follows the angle of the guard. And this is kind of just packaged into a bit of free space that we've got on the side of the outlet of the bumper. So this whole duct is going to be bolted to the guard itself. So this is going to have there's a secondary piece that's going to go on the outside that's going to have a gurney as well. The idea behind the gurney is it'll just create a bit of a low pressure area in the area of the outlet of the duct, which is what we want to help draw air air through the oil cooler, but this essentially bolts to the inside of the bumper. So this whole system, when the bumper comes off, which is the bumper itself is actually on quick release pins, this whole thing comes out of the car, and that's why this system, this is, we are not actually going to have bolt holes as shown on here. This is actually going to be sitting on a sealed foam flange that sits against the oil cooler. So the idea is this can come on and off without having to be unbolted off the car. Sorry, off the oil cooler. We've had a revision, so we've since we've test fitted this to the car, and this is always a little bit the case when it comes to building parts like this where you don't have a full 3D scan of the car. It's always a case of taking a few measurements, going back and forward, taking your best guess, printing it, and then once you've printed it, you've actually got a reference to start measuring some positions to see how far you are out on dimensions and angles and stuff like that. So based on that, we've gone to a different version. So the main difference to the first version is that looking overhead, we've actually increased the amount of angle here. So we needed to point this oil cooler face a little bit more towards the oil cooler. I've obviously deleted those bolt holes, as this is now just going to be sitting hard against the oil cooler passively. Now this is not the, this is far from the final version. The position of the flanges is relatively final, but it's actually, you can kind of see through the, best way to see it through there, you can see through the, looking through the front there, there's this big step that comes in, and you can kind of see it probably best from the outside. You can see this big crease running through here. So this is really not a great thing from an airflow perspective. This is the direction of the flow is from this flange here, and this is the outlet that comes out of here. So the air coming through this part of the duct and out here, we really don't want any really steep corner, any steep corners or big changes of section, any rapid changes of section. This is where you end up with a lot of separation. You'll end up with a big dead patch in the flow here, which is obviously something we don't want because we're trying to maximize the flow here. So it's while the position of the flanges is good, we're going to have to go back and do a little bit of tweaking on the loft we've got running from this face to this face. It's obviously a relatively complex loft. We're going from this quite simple shape here on this plane through to something that's on a really different plane and both vertically, horizontally, and an angle wise, and through to a completely different shape. So it is a relatively complicated loft, but we're just going to have to do a little bit more work in CAD to get that loft going a bit smoother to get rid of this junction here. That's something we want to avoid. So that's going to be a little bit of an ongoing project to get that working properly in the car. So this week we had a really great video come out talking about Formula SAE, or what's called Formula Student in some parts of the world, carbon monocoque tub being built. So we did a series of interviews at the rear end of last year where I went and talked to a couple of local Formula Student teams. Any of you guys that aren't familiar with Formula Student, it's essentially a university competition where people build small formula style race cars and they get together and race them, and it's a massive competition. It's international competition, and the standard of cars is typically very high. Lots of really interesting stuff to look at on the cars. If I just head across to my laptop screen again, I've got that video loaded up here. So this is one of the cars we talked about in the interview. This is a full carbon monocoque chassis. So typically Formula SAE cars in the past, well, what they used to be built from was a steel space frame, so a pretty old school style of way of building a car. These days, almost all teams, certainly all the top teams, would be building full carbon monocoques. So carbon monocoques isn't something that is typically accessible to most of us building cars in our own sheds or workshops. It's something that you definitely see at the highest ends of motorsport, so obviously Formula One, the high end of sports cars with prototypes and lots of single seaters, whether it's modern Formula 3, Formula 4, certain GP2, Formula 2, stuff like that. These are the kind of levels of cars that are typically being built in carbon monocoque. Carbon monocoque, for any of you guys that aren't exactly sure what that is, essentially it's a sandwich material. So you've got a carbon skin on the inside, followed by a core material, which can be made up of different choices, whether it's a honeycomb or an aluminium or an aramid style core, and then an outer skin. So inner skin, core, outer skin. The inner and outer is a carbon typically, and that inner skin, that inner section in the middle, the core material, is to give a separation between those two, the two parts of the core, so the two parts of the carbon. And the idea is it gives you a lot more bending resistance, it gives you a lot of stiffness for not a lot of weight. So I thought it was a really interesting interview we went through. It was Ben from UCM that talked us through both from a project management perspective, for what's actually involved in making this thing, right through, right from making the molds through to the different materials they use and why they use different materials at each point. I thought it was a really interesting interview, and if you guys are interested in learning about some, I would say, relatively high-tech chassis manufacture techniques, I definitely encourage you guys to go and check that out. The forum is again being relatively active at the moment. I'm spending quite a lot of time on there every day with people asking really great questions. I just want to skip across there. I'll jump across to my laptop screen and we'll go through a couple that I had recently. And there's actually one that was actually on the question about some cooling and ductwork. So I'm not sure if I spoke about it in the previous webinar, but we did a video on basic ducting design. So the idea being having a diverging and converging, so diverging on the inlet and converging on the outlet duct design to help maximize the cooling efficiency of the car. And there are a couple of, you can find that on YouTube and I think probably also on Instagram as well. But essentially we had someone here asking, I talked quite a lot, quite extensively in the video about the inlet duct design, but I did actually end up glossing over the outlet duct design. And we had Michael here ask a question of, what are the rules? I gave some rules of thumb for how the inlet should typically be designed and typically work. But he was asking, how does the outlet work? What sort of rules of thumb are there? And the answer is really, it's really similar to what's happening on the inlet side. It's just essentially on the reverse. So on the inlet side, we are trying to slow the flow down by expanding the duct as it approaches the heat exchanger. And on the outlet, we're doing the opposite. So we're converging it back down. And the idea is that we're trying to recover some of the kinetic energy. We want, ideally, for the whole ducting system to work properly, the flow going through the car, which is going through our heat exchangers, and the point where it exits out of the car. We roughly want the speed of the flow exiting out of the car to be similar to what's happening in the air that's flowing over top of the car. That's when we get the most efficient, the most efficiency from a drag perspective, and it's also, it helps draw the air through the ducting as well. So that was just Michael's question there, and there was a little bit of discourse back and forward on that. So if you're interested in a little bit more, a bit of a discussion about the ducting stuff, I definitely recommend you go and check out that post that was posted under the general section, and then in the cooling package ductwork, if you're interested in going and checking that out. So we've still got a couple more courses in development that are going to be coming out soon. We've got our advanced data analysis course, which ties in well to what we're going to be talking today about math channels. And we've also got our driving fundamentals course, our race driving fundamentals course, which is currently in production. We haven't started filming it yet, but we are hoping to have it out pretty soon. So definitely keep an eye out for those guys, if you're interested, guys. So that's the end of the pre-show for today. We'll cut it off there, and I will be back in a second, and we'll get into the lesson talking about math channels. If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.